Для меня оригинальность заключается в том, что что-то не существовало.
For me, originality is when something is there, which wasn't there before. Basically, a mystery.
Это тайна.
On the other hand, I also think that there's no such thing as originality, because nothing comes from nothing.
Потому что ничто не появляется из ничего.
Welcome to MIF Originals, a brand new podcast series from Manchester International Festival. It's a podcast about originality and the nature of creativity. I'm your host, Isaiah Hall, and as a writer, I care about originality because originality, or the idea of originality, makes people go, ooh, like where do I find this thing, this new thing? And it gives a hope for the future. Not everything has been done already. And that unknown space is exciting. During this podcast season, five amazing artists developing new work for this year's festival will have a blank audio canvas to fill. A chance to try something new with the podcast form. Episode 1 is from the award-winning novelist Adam Thirlwell. The project he's bringing to this year's festival is Studio Creole, which Adam describes as an attempt to put the audience into the mind of God, where they can understand many languages at once, turning literature and translation into live art. Here's Adam to explain more, and I recommend you listen to this episode in headphones.
I'm a novelist, and me, I've always had this anxiety or confusion about the business I do, because a novel is an international object. It's part of an international history, and it's designed to be read internationally, not just in London or New York, but also Tokyo, Reykjavik. In that way, obviously, it's just like other art forms, like a film or a piece of music or some conceptual art. Except a novel only exists in words. Its medium is language. And language is, or at least certainly that's how we currently understand it, inherently and irrevocably national. So it kind of looks impossible to be a novelist. Sure, you're going to say, as if the solution is obvious. There's translation.
One thing that's possible is that without anticipating this state at all, you wake up and are suddenly unable to imagine how you will complete the slightest action. Even reaching the door from the bed can seem a distant prospect.
The more you think about translation, the crazier it gets. And as the writers and readers of novels, let's just pause on a single thing. None of the words you're reading when you read a translation are words chosen by the novelist. And yet, of course, the main thing a novelist cares about are the precise words she's chosen. The more carefully written a novel is, the more valuable it is for a reader. But at the same time, a novel that only exists for readers in one language isn't really a novel at all. It isn't part of the novel's international history. The more you think about this, the more you have to change your basic definitions of a novel or a style or a language. Or translation. Everything has to become woozy and elastic. However, I don't want to talk about translation, not right now. What I want to talk about is interpreting. And the difference is kind of simple. Literary translation is what happens when someone sits down with a text in another language and spends as much time as they can trying to work out equivalents for this text in a new language. Whereas interpreting is what happens when someone's speaking live and at the same time, someone else tries to say what they're saying in a new language. Obviously, these two techniques are kind of radically different. However, it's also true that however much literary translation tries to remove as many slippages, slippages and mistakes and rewritings as possible, the deep anxiety that is a true and justified anxiety is that every act of translation is an act of risk and trust, like any communication between two people and any form of being read. And therefore, although live interpreting might seem different to literary translation, I think they're more on a continuum, a kind of water slide of simultaneous loss, confusion and mayhem, and also beauty and invention. As long as I've been a novelist, I've also been thinking about translation. I've written essays, I've set up wacky experiments. But now, I'm also interested in thinking about interpretation. I'm sure there's an autobiographical reason for this. The more you do readings internationally, the more you're dependent on interpreters, and the more vulnerable you feel. Also, the more interested you become in the different possibilities for interpreting. The varieties are startling. I once did an entire interview in Latin America where the interpreter was in another room, and she would speak to me, this voice nestled in my earpiece, being rude about the other speakers, expressing boredom, exasperation, until I felt I knew her. I never even saw what she looked like. Or there is the other extreme, where a stranger is suddenly sat beside you or behind you, whispering constantly into your ear, so close that you can smell them, so that interpreting becomes this deeply physical and invading process. The more this happens, the more you realize that you are always a guest dependent on your host every time you're being read in translation. And you are a host with a guest every time you are reading a translation. And yet, it feels like we're very cautious when it comes to interpreting. We're nervous about how to do it or stage it. Like, how does it happen on the radio? Normally, someone speaks for a second in their language, and then they're faded out.
Normally, someone speaks for a second, and then they're faded out, and the interpreter takes over.
But at this point, I want to digress and state something. All of this has obviously the kind of background noise of my concern for something you could call world literature. As I think I was saying, the more you think from this perspective, the more your normal ideas tend to get upended. And I think the most radical is, in a way, the most obvious. Those who want to hasten the era of world literature will have to accept one vast novelty: the deconstruction of the idea of the single language. The world cannot be said in a single language, just as a person isn't bound to a single language either. I don't mean that this isn't a strange way to think. We're so rooted in the idea of a single language, a mother tongue, and of a person's identity as in some way correspondingly single and transparent, that any attempt to think in terms of a world or a planet is very difficult. It can feel artificial or even unnatural. But what a future world literature will require is the knowledge that a language isn't something that belongs to a landscape or a nation or a person. If you want to invent a future form called world literature, all small scale and minuscule, I have this idea that you therefore can't just refuse the absence of translation. In fact, two absences need to be reversed for world literature to happen: the absence of translation, but also the absence of the original, which happens when you read a translation. Translation is wonderful and necessary, but the danger of translation is the absence of the original language, which I think is why I have this vision of literature as something that could be instead a little gathering, like a party or a deconstructed conference, a soft machine. And of course, this is something the world does know about already, but outside literature, it's something you see in international criminal courts or the United Nations. Its model is the highest politics. After World War II, when the Nuremberg trials were prosecuting the alleged perpetrators of mass crimes and genocide, they decided that they would hold the proceedings in four languages at once. From then on, therefore, they not only had invented international justice, but they were forced to invent a whole new mode of simultaneous translation, which has become the mode we associate with all international criminal proceedings. And that's why I've invited my friend Philippe Sands, a best-selling author and international lawyer, to talk for a little bit about exactly what happened at Nuremberg.
When the trial was being conceived, the need for interpretation was immediately recognised. But the difficulty was that if you had consecutive interpretation, that's to say, if a prosecutor might speak first in English or French or Russian and then wait for a translation to German, that would double the length of the proceedings. Since the idea was that the trial should be done and dusted in 6 months, the other idea emerged of simultaneous interpretation. It was a technique essentially to speed up the process of the trial, to bring it to a quick and early end. And interpreters were brought in from many countries. I think there were more than 20 of them. I happen to have met the last living interpreter, a wonderful man called Siegfried Ramler. He was born in Austria. He left that country when the Nazis took over because he was Jewish. He made his way to the United States, joined the US Army, fought in Europe, and because of his language skills, found himself entirely accidentally and without any real training as an interpreter in the Nuremberg trial. He told me how he found himself face to face with Hans Frank, former Governor General of Nazi-occupied Poland, who was responsible for the killings of many of his family and friends. This was a tough, tough exercise. It was, for him, I think, extremely sensitive, even when I spoke to him about it 70 years later. And that sensitivity accords with my own experience. I often argue before international courts and tribunals. The Peace Palace in The Hague, for example, it's essentially been the same cast of characters for years. So I've come to know them very well. I've come to trust them and understand how exceptionally good they are at what they do and how delicate is their work. And of course, there's something else. Day in and day out, they're listening to these subjects in court, interpreting. So they have a deep, substantive understanding of what's going on. In fact, sometimes they know best the sense of the room. And I'll have a conversation informally with an interpreter that I've come to know well to get a sense from her or from him of the impressions that have been obtained during a day's hearing in court. The interpreter can really tell how a case is going, how attentive the judges are, how effective the advocates have been. For simultaneous interpretation, because of the intensity of the exercise, the maximum you can reasonably do is about 30 minutes at any one go. It's an extraordinarily tough job. And some of the interpreters have had post-traumatic stress treatment because some of the subjects they're interpreting are so very terrible. The Nuremberg model worked. No one complained about the quality of the interpretation, and it has become the standard model for international institutions, for cases before international courts and tribunals. Of course, it's been refined. The technology has improved. At the UN, you have simultaneous interpretation, not just in three or four languages, but in six. And in the European Union, it's two or three times that number. So the complexities have increased, but the essential skills are the same. I just end by saying that the community of simultaneous interpreters is truly a remarkable group. They're intelligent, they're hugely hardworking, and incredibly adept at picking up on the nuances of meanings and words, what is said, the silences. And often their work is imbued with a terrific sense of humour. The International Court of Justice, one of the things we as counsels sometimes like to do is throw in a word or a phrase that might confuse our interpreters who have become our friends. A classic one I've used is to talk about an argument that my opponent is making as a red herring. Sometimes that does get interpreted as an hareng rouge, a red herring, literally in French, meaningless. And so we rely on our fabulous interpreters to break the atmosphere, to lighten the load. In The Hague, in Washington, Paris, Lausanne, other places, I've come to really appreciate the singular quality of our interpreters.
What I'm trying to say with all this, what I'm trying to say in this entire podcast, is that you can't deny the multiple voices in this world. It's true of justice, and I think it's also true of art, and specifically true of literature. We need to see all language uses as a continuum, a slide. But how do you do this with sound? How do you make a machine for staging stories where you could hear both the original and a translation at the same time? That's the kind of ideal I'm trying to pursue here. How can you set up a recording studio for world literature where the original exists at the same time as its translation? A form of preservation for the multiple languages in the world. On the radio, as I said, the model is always the fade out. But I want to do the opposite of a fade out. And what else can we do? Well, you could, one, Have two spoken at once, one of them super dramatic, the other one super monotonous, like a political congress. 5. Leave a language untranslated.
Блин, не могу поверить, что вы все еще слушаете этот подкаст. Вы еще не устали? Еще много осталось. Мне совсем мало заплатили за то, чтобы заниматься этим говном. Вы, наверное, не понимаете, что я говорю, да?
And if you do have an interpreter, what kind should you use? A person? And if so, who? A friend? A trained interpreter? Or a machine? 6. Let Google Translate take over.
Lascia che Google Translate prenda il sopravvento.
Hayaan ang Google Translate na magbayad.
Niech Google Translate przejmie kontrolę.
Låt Google översätt ta över.
Google 翻訳 を引き継ぐ.
So we decided to do some experiments on a story I wrote, which the Chilean novelist Alejandro Zambra once translated into Spanish. It's a story I wrote a while ago for the Serpentine Galleries, a story I called Five Prophecies. It's very short, and it's about what happens when you move from one state to another, which can be as simple as walking from one side of a bridge to the other. Five Prophecies. One thing that's possible is that without anticipating this state at all, you wake up and are suddenly unable to imagine how you will complete the slightest action. Even reaching the door from the bed can seem a distant prospect. And then once you've made it to the door, how many steps must you go down to the kitchen? And then how many operations just to make a cup of coffee? It's a wonder anyone survives even the beginning of a day, let alone an entire week. For once you discover the infinite inside things, it's very wearing and dispiriting. And that is what once happened to Jaleesa. Not, to be precise, when she was waking up, but when she stood there on a bridge. Or, to be even more precise, just before a bridge, and realized that even inside this small walk ahead of her from one side of the bridge to the other, there were an infinite amount of moments to negotiate. Jaleesa was a bodybuilder, and probably it's true that if there has ever been a golden age of female bodybuilding, then we are in it. But still, however content she should have been, at this moment, Jaleesa was experiencing something that she could only call fear. But really what she was feeling was possibly much stranger and more terrible. Because it really is terrible when you consider how far away things are from each other. Just think about the space there is between you and the nearest tree, then between the leaves themselves, and from the leaves to the twigs and the smallest branches. It's basically impossible to reach anything at all, or sometimes it can seem so. To think of the infinity inside the smallest motion, and it was making Jaleesa realize how many prophecies she could make, even concerning a single walk. For instance, according to Jaleesa, five things were going to happen before she reached the other side of the bridge. 1. She knew that when she saw the water, she would want to look down at it. And this happened. 2. She knew that if a car went past, it would make her think of her dead father. And this happened. 3. She knew that a wind would suddenly make the sound in her headphones go crazy. And this happened. 4. Also, she knew that she would think about a boy who was right now far away in another country. Because if you chose any 5-minute period in her life right now, she would be thinking about him at least once. And this happened. It happened more than once. 5. But also she knew that as soon as she reached the other side, she would pause and hail a taxi to take her to the gym for her day's training. And while this almost happened, it did not. And the story of how this prophecy did not come true is of some interest and perhaps also instructive. She was walking along the bridge and had immediately paused to look down into the water and observe her crumpled reflection. Then a car went past which made her think of her dead father, who had a crazy love of cars which she never could reciprocate. And then the wind was so loud that she could not hear the song she was playing on her iPod for a moment. And this song, as always, made her think about the boy far away in another country with whom she had recently spent a crazy night, where she told him various secrets of her sexual history in her teenage years. And at 4 in the morning, they had finally parted with this knowledge that, although they had not slept together, they did both believe that at some point in this life they would be naked together in a bed. And it was this thought that accompanied her to the other side of the bridge, where she paused to hail a taxi. She stood there, waiting. And perhaps if a taxi had arrived immediately, then Jaleesa would have gone to the gym and her final prophecy would have come true. But she was thinking so much of this boy in another country that it suddenly occurred to her that no, she would not hail a taxi because she would not go to the gym, and that in fact she would never go to a gym ever again. There it was. She was no longer a bodybuilder. She knew this very abruptly, but also completely. That's how quickly your life can change. And when you think about it, that's a relief that things can change so fast, when you also consider how infinite and slow they are as well. There it was.
Вот и все. Она больше не была бодибилдером. Она поняла это сразу же и полностью. Вот так быстро может поменяться жизнь. Когда думаешь об этом, это облегчение, что вещи могут меняться так быстро, но так же, как медленно и бесконечно они могут меняться.
Hi, I am Alejandro Zambra. I am a Chilean writer. I am not a translator, but I did translate this short story because I liked it very much. And I wanted to share it with some people. And, well, I hope you like it. And if you don't like it, you can be sure that that is because of my translation. Cinco profecías. Una posibilidad es que, sin prever este estado en lo absoluto, despiertes y de pronto seas incapaz de imaginar cómo completar la más sencilla acción. Incluso llegar hasta la puerta desde la cama puede parecer un proyecto lejano. Y entonces, cuando has conseguido llegar a la puerta, ¿cuántos pasos debes dar hasta la cocina? Y después, ¿cuántas acciones solo para prepararte una taza de café? Es un milagro que cualquiera sobreviva incluso al comienzo de un día, ni qué decir a una semana entera. Porque una vez que descubres el infinito dentro de las cosas, todo se vuelve muy agotador y deprimente. Y eso le pasó una vez a Jaleesa, no al despertar, para ser preciso, sino cuando estaba en un puente, o para ser aún más preciso, justo antes de cruzar un puente. Y se dio cuenta de que incluso en esta breve caminata de un lado al otro del puente, había una cantidad infinita de momentos que considerar. Jaleesa era fisicoculturista. Y probablemente sea cierto que si alguna vez ha habido algo así, como una edad de oro del fisicoculturismo femenino, vivimos en ella. Pero aún así, por más satisfecha que Jaleesa estuviera, ahora experimentaba algo que solo podía llamar miedo. Pero en realidad lo que sentía era posiblemente más extraño y más terrible. Porque realmente es terrible cuando te detienes a pensar cuán lejos están unas cosas de otras. Solo piensa en el espacio que te separa del árbol más cercano y luego la distancia de una hoja a la otra y de las hojas a las ramas y a las más intrincadas ramificaciones. Es básicamente imposible alcanzar algo en lo absoluto, o a veces puede parecer así. Pensar en la infinitud que late en los movimientos más pequeños. Y eso hizo que Jaleesa considerara cuántas profecías podía formular acerca de una simple caminata. Por ejemplo, de acuerdo con Jaleesa, cinco cosas habrían de suceder antes de llegar al otro lado del puente. Uno. Sabía que cuando viera el agua querría detenerse a mirar la corriente. Y así fue. Dos. Sabía que si pasaba un auto,
she
knew that if
she passed a car, she would remember her dead father, and that's how it was.
3.
3.
Sabía que una ventolera haría que el sonido en sus audífonos de pronto enloqueciera.
Suddenly, what it will be, and that's how it was.
Cuatro.
Four.
También sabía que pensaría en un hombre que ahora estaba lejos, en otro país.
Think a man who was now far away in another country, because if we would take any 5-minute loop of his life and had been thinking about that man at least once.
Y así fue. Y más de una vez.
And so it was, and more than once.
5.
5.
Pero también sabía que tan pronto como llegara al otro lado, se detendría a esperar un taxi para ir al gimnasio a entrenar. Y aunque esto casi pasó, no pasó. Y la historia de cómo esta profecía no se cumplió es de muy interés, y quizás sea también instructiva. Iba por el puente y a poco andar, sabía detenido a mirar el agua y observar las estelas de su reflejo. Entonces pasó un auto que la hizo recordar a su padre muerto, que amaba locamente los autos. Y ella nunca pudo estar a la altura de ese amor. Y entonces el viento pegó tan fuerte que por un momento ya no pudo escuchar la canción en su oído. Una canción que siempre le recordaba al hombre que estaba lejos en otro país, con quien recientemente había pasado una noche loca, en la que ella le había contado varios secretos de su historia sexual y de su adolescencia. Y a las 4 de la mañana se habían separado, sabiendo que aunque no habían dormido juntos, aunque creían que en algún momento de that at some point in this life they would be together naked in a bed. Y fue este pensamiento el que la condujo al otro lado del puente.
That he led her to the other side of the bridge where he stopped to get a taxi.
Se quedó ahí, esperando.
He stayed there waiting.
Y quizá si un taxi hubiera llegado de inmediato, ya Lisa habría ido al gimnasio y su última profecía se habría cumplido. Pero pensaba con tal intensidad en ese hombre en otro país que de repente su
pensamiento se
convirtió en
un taxi,
porque no iba a ir al gimnasio, que de hecho nunca más iría a ningún gimnasio. Así, de pronto.
She knew this very abruptly, but also completely. That's how quickly your life can change. And when you think about it, that's a relief that things can change so fast.
That's how fast life can change.
When you also consider how infinite and slow they are as well.
And really a relief that things can change so fast when you stop to think about how infinite and slow they can be too.
Now, the finale there of Alejandro's translation of my story was all retranslated there by Google Translate. And I love Google Translate, but I also have one maybe political anxiety. The map of Google Translate is the map of the world's current hierarchies. It's algorithmic, and therefore it's dependent on how much data it receives for how good it can make itself. When there's a lot of data, like Spanish to English, it can be wonderful. When there's very little data, like maybe Spanish to Kikuyu, it's less impressive. But then that isn't a problem with the tech, I think, so much as a problem with the world. And the more we think about these technical inventions, the more multiple we can hopefully make the world. I mean, I know, all these phonic tricks we're doing here are games. No one needs to listen to a story like this, and it may, in many ways, destroy it. But sometimes when you interrupt a process, you can also make discoveries about what's really going on, which you never noticed when inside the flow of it. And in interrupting a story with its translation or the other way round, I think it's possible to come to some conclusions. It's possible to turn writing into something closer to conceptual art. I mean, to think about a story not just for its meaning, but also for what any story is at all. It's also possible to come up with much more intricate phonic models of what it is to read a story in translation. It's possible to use and improve many more wacky tech experiments. And the fact that at the moment it seems so mismatched or even clunky is a proof that we think far too old-fashionedly about the language in which we write or read or think. And what's most striking is the giant amount of moments in an interpretation when something is endangered. Just think about that other art of interpretation, gossip. Think how almost always you feel you are misquoted when someone tells you something you once said to them. But that fragility of giving yourself up to another person shouldn't stop the process of translation and multiplicity. It should make us even more intent on making that process audible. And of course, one other way of rethinking things is in the work itself. And for me, the major shift is in thinking about what a reader is, or more precisely, where she is. Because sure, I write stories in English, but why should that mean that the best or even intended reader of a story is an anglophonic one? A novel's international, after all. Its truest reader might be located thousands of miles away in Santiago, reading in Spanish. And once you think like that, you might well change how you think about an original and a copy, and an original language and a translated language. A translation might just seem like a second original or a new creation.
Если мы будем думать об этом, то вполне можно принять свое мнение о оригинале и о копии, о языке оригинале и о языке перевода. Перевод может казаться просто вторым оригиналом или новым творением.
That was Adam Thirlwell's Polyglot Radio. I have to say, it's very interesting at the top of the episode when he mentions novels having to be translatable to other nations to reach another state of validity. When I write, I'm never thinking of it being translated. Maybe that's just the stage I am in my career and it's just where I am now. But the words I write are meant for me to be said to myself. Whether I read them or I perform them or somebody else is reading them, I just think I'm meant to say this to myself for myself. I don't consider translatability in my own work. And so I felt challenged, which is good. It made me think of why I love my language so much. Like, why don't I consider other languages? Very interesting. Okay, basically, now, for each of these episodes, I'm sharing an original poem in response to what we've heard. The art of translation brings up the idea of a universal language. This made me think of body language being a universal language. Algebra, which I was taught is universal, is the same in every country. And the word Alleluia, which connects to God, and it's the same in every language. Algebra raises its neck. I see the bodies deliver respect. We were in common once, but nonetheless, every apology falls on its face. Translate, translate. Algebra weak in the knees, body of me sending a message. Letters led me to a dead end, X, Y, and Z, head high indeed. Translate, translate. Algebra sounding an ape, mouth full of grapes, body get good at escape. Alleluia in reverse, this time hurts, wearing disguise of my words once I learned how to lie first. Algebra down on his luck, body a folly a duh, God without love, series a little too much, serious sirs, sit with the sir, see I say the words, nobody heard me, then they all listen, isn't it perfect? I love with the sound of a square, so I build a house, but she isn't there. Now I am without a flower affair, so why use the mouth when it can't repair? I was en route to it, now in air. Hours of fruits found in my hair, down at the roots, about to relate. Cloud is a tooth, it chows on the air. Out of the blue, how do you do a mountain a day? Powerful proof is sounding yourself when everyone else in the room lies. From far away, real recognize real, it translates through the eyes. Origin, man-made, in his mind. Thanks for listening to the first episode of MIF Originals, written by and featuring novelist Adam Thirlwell, whose Studio Creole opens at Manchester Academy on Friday the 12th of July, 2019. You also heard the voices of author and barrister Philippe Sands, Russian interpreter Natalia Gregg, Manx broadcaster Bob Carswell, and writer Alejandro Zambra. The music was by Vicky Clarke and Mira Calix. It was presented by me, Isaiah Hall, and produced by Jack Howson. It's a reduced listening and MIF production.